大家好，我是凯瑟琳·格罗夫 ,INTI 出版公司的总裁。今天我在这里采访比尔·奎恩博士，和他谈谈他的畅销书《生产消费者力量》。作为九本书的作者、演说家和商业顾问，比尔在19岁的时候就拥有自己的生意了。比尔·奎恩是佛罗里达大学市场营销教授，被四所大学评为杰出教授。比尔在14岁的时候就几乎失明，但他并没有让他的残疾阻碍他的前进。事实上，这从来没有使他放慢他的前进速度，因为他不能开车，他划皮艇回大学上班。出人意料的是，人们总是向比尔咨询应该如何计划他们的未来。
凯瑟琳，今天我很高兴能够和你交谈，并且和听众们分享我的故事。我很感谢你刚才对我的介绍，因为我几乎算是失明，所以我用不同的角度来看问题。划皮艇上班的确很有意思，是一个很棒的经历，这给了我每天早上思考的时间，真是太好了。我很高兴能够来到这里和大家分享生产消费这个概念。
比尔，划皮艇上班听起来真的很不错，这样既避开了交通堵塞，又避免了汽车废气。
确实很棒，我从来没有在水上遇到过交通堵塞。
比尔，你也知道，我很喜欢《生产消费力量》这本书，很喜欢这个概念。在看这本书之前，我从来没有听说过“生产消费者”这个词。当然，我听说过“生产者”，也听说过“消费者”，但从来没有听说过“生产消费者”。你能告诉我们这个词是怎么来的吗？
当然可以。生产消费者是一个由生产者和消费者组成的合成词。我们都知道消费者是什么，那就是花钱买东西的人。
对，
我们都是消费者，我们都要购买我们所需的日用品。我们也知道生产者是什么，生产者赚钱，消费者花钱，生产者赚钱，生产消费者就是在花钱的同时赚钱。事实上，生产消费者学会了去定位自己，以便能够更聪明，而不是更便宜的购物，从而创造财富。
好的，生产消费者在花钱的同时赚钱。
完全正确，这是一个很棒的概念，这也正是我要在这盒磁带里解释的概念。
比尔，这的确是一个有趣的概念，你能不能举一个生产消费的实际例子呢？
凯瑟琳，当然可以。以下这个例子是每个人都能明白的，因为每个人都在做这件事情。让我们来看看这盒磁带的题目，你拥有你的生活还是在租用它？我们可以用这个题目来解释生产消费主义，因为人人都明白拥有自己的房子胜过租房子。拥有自己的房子是美国人梦想的基石，从小时候开始，我们就明白到要购买自己的房子，并且增加房子里的资产。我们每个月支付房屋贷款的时候，我们的确花了一些钱在利息上，这是真的。但我们还花钱在增加我们的房子的资产上。相反，那些只是租房子的人，他们每个月所花的钱就这样白白溜走了。凯瑟琳，接下来我会用一些大概的数字来举例说明。虽然这些数字可能不太现实，但是容易理解。
好的。
假设你可以每个月花$1000来供房子，也可以花$500来租房子。如果你买房子，你每个月花$1000，一年就是$12000。
没错。
但是这笔钱会增加你的房子的资产，它在创造房子的拥有权。如果你每个月花$500来租房子，你每年只需花$6000。但是这$6000里的每一美元都是支付给你的房东，帮助他建立他所梦想的房子拥有权，而不是你的。你们可以看到，问题的关键就是要当生产消费者。生产消费者通过更聪明而不是更便宜的购物来创造财富。如果我们买一所房子，我们要支付房屋贷款。当我们付清房屋贷款之后，我们就拥有了房子，还得到了房子增值的好处。所以我们要更聪明的购物，而不一定是要更便宜。我们也可以选择租房子，那少花些钱也许会更便宜， 但是这不是更明智的做法。下面让我们来看一看买房子和租房子的对比。根据这个，你可以知道你是想拥有你的生活，还是想租用它。如果你买房子，你是在投资；如果你租房子，你就是在支出。你的钱从你的口袋里流走，而且永远不会回来了。如果你买了房子，还能够享受房子增值的好处。当房价上涨的时候，你把房子卖掉，它就会变成你口袋里的钱。如果你租房子，房子增值的机会就属于你的房东了。
说的没错。
这是你本来可以赚到的钱。当你拥有房子，你创造财富；当你租房子，你是在消耗你的财富。如果我们拥有房子，我们还会得到税务豁免，政府会为你支付部分房屋贷款。如果我们租房子，房东就拥有税务豁免。最重要的是，当我们拥有房子，我们就建立了拥有者权益。正是拥有者权益让我们创造长期的财富。拥有房子就是生产消费者力量的一个典型例子。
没错。
是的，所有人都明白这个道理。让我们来看看美国人。在美国，只有1/3的人拥有自己的房子。我敢保证，剩下的1/3也想拥有自己的房子，只是因为由于某些原因，也许他们没有钱支付房子的首期付款，也许他们需要经常搬家。有一样东西为美国经济建立了坚实的基础，那就是房屋拥有权。我们的税法也是专门保护这种经济基础的。这些就是正在发挥作用的生产消费者力量。我们把拥有房屋的原则运用到购买日常生活用品上，教人们运用生产消费的力量来创造投资、拥有者权益、税务豁免以及财富，通过更聪明而不是更便宜的购物来帮助他们创造财富。
比尔，我知道你有一个有趣的故事，是关于租用和拥有的，你能和大家分享一下吗？
当然可以。凯瑟琳，我很喜欢这个故事。有一个人，他的舅舅去世了，他很爱他的舅舅，他舅舅生前也很爱他。他要给他的舅舅举行一个最隆重的葬礼，遗憾的是他的工作太忙了，不能参加他舅舅的葬礼。于是他打电话给殡仪馆，他说，我要给我舅舅举行一个体面的葬礼，这对我来说真的很重要，你们只需要把账单寄给我就行了。就这样，葬礼举行了，但是这个人还是很忙，没能出席。大约过了一个月，他收到了殡仪馆寄来的账单，一共是32,000美元。他想，这个葬礼虽然花了很多钱，但是我让他们举行了一个一流的葬礼，舅舅值得我这样做。一个月之后，他又收到殡仪馆寄来的85美元账单，他觉得很奇怪，但是他还是付款了。接下来的几个月，每个月他都收到85美元账单，他还是继续付款。4-5个月之后，他想看看殡仪馆对此有何解释，于是他打电话给殡仪馆的经理，他说，你们帮我舅舅举行的葬礼实在太棒了，人人都称赞不已，遗憾的是我本人没能参加，但是我很想知道为什么我每个月都收到一张85美元的账单呢？殡仪馆的经理说，这很简单，你要求我们为你的舅舅举行一个一流的葬礼，我们都做到了，为了让他看起来气色好一些，我们帮他租了一套燕尾服。看来这个人下半辈子都要支付那套燕尾服的租金了。
租一套燕尾服？
他租了一套燕尾服，而他本来应该把燕尾服买下来的。
对，比尔，你说如果你想拥有更多，你就要像店铺那样思考。在你的书中，你提到了斯坦店，我想这是一个像店铺那样思考的很好的例子，它还是一个更明智的购物，而不是更便宜购物的好例子。比尔，你能和我们一起分享一下这个故事吗？
当然可以，凯瑟琳，你说的完全正确。斯坦店就是一个很好的例子。人们要学会不同的思维，如果你学会用不同的方式来思维，你就能创造财富。如果你的思维和别人的一样，你就只能拥有你本来拥有的东西。 斯坦就是一个有不同的思维的人，这是一个与人合作的好例子，让我来解释一下。斯坦先生在美国中西部的一个城市里经营一家商店，他的商店已经开了很多年了，位于城市的主要街道上。他有一批忠诚的顾客，他们都喜欢。斯坦先生服务周到，而且价格合理。一天，斯坦先生听到他隔壁两边的店铺传来装修的声音。一家店铺挂起了一块巨大的霓虹灯招牌，写着大型折扣连锁店。在他的商店的另一边，一家店铺挂起了全城最低价的招牌。这两家商店展开了价格战。很快，斯坦店的老顾客们经过斯坦店，去这些大商店寻求折扣了。斯坦觉得他也要想想办法了。于是他想，我该怎么做呢？我该怎么做呢？他把他的员工集中到一起，但是大家都没有想出好主意。一天，他以前的一个老顾客走进他的商店，他四处看了看，说：哦，不好意思，我走错地方了，这是斯坦店。斯坦先生恍然大悟，他说：这就是问题所在。我的顾客都认为这是我的商店，我要做的就是让顾客认为这是他们自己的商店。
没错。
他想出了一个办法，他给顾客们折扣，帮助他们创造收入。顾客们只需要做两件事情，或者在他的商店购物，或者介绍其他人来商店购物。两种情况下都可以得到佣金。事实证明，这个生意模式比斯坦先生想象的还要成功。他的老顾客开始重新回来，感谢他周到的服务，他的诚实，他精心挑选的商品等等。他们只需要支付非常合理的价格。斯坦对他的客户说，这个商店过去叫做斯坦店，现在它叫做你的店。如果你介绍顾客来我们这里购物，我就会根据他们的销售额给你佣金。而且，如果你所介绍的顾客介绍别人来购物，我仍然会根据他们的销售额给你佣金。这样，消费者就变成了生产消费者。作为生产者的斯坦先生，则变成了生产消费者的合作伙伴。这就是生产消费者的力量。
所以，斯坦先生开始把他的顾客看成是合作伙伴，是生产者的一员，而不仅仅是消费者。
凯瑟琳，你说的非常正确。斯坦先生还需要教育他的客户用正确的方式来思考，因为消费者的心态就是追求折扣。如果他可以教他们成功的方法，通过成为生产消费者来创造自己的财富，很快他们就会在自己的店里购物了。
说得对。
这就是生产消费者力量的精髓，那就是向你自己以及和你的合作伙伴购买，并且通过教育别人改变购物习惯来创造自己的财富。你在我的店购物，而不是去别的商店。
因此，斯坦先生让这些人拥有自己的生意，他们可以在自己的商店里购物，他们可以更明智的购物，而不是更便宜的。最重要的是，他们在花钱的同时能够赚钱。
对，他们仍然在买日常用品，他们一直都在买日常用品，他们买的东西还是和以往一样多，他们仍然在买他们以前买的东西，只是改变了购物的方式。他们改变了他们的购物习惯，他们改变了他们的思维，然后他们就改变了他们的生活。
对，斯坦先生告诉他们，如果你想拥有更多，你就要像店铺那样思考。
对于我们的听众，这是一个很好的启发。要知道，消费者花钱，这些都是纯粹的开支，店铺赚钱，这些则是收入。你愿意像创造开支的人那样思考呢，还是像创造收入的人那样思考呢？要从消费者变成生产消费者，你就要开始像店铺那样思考。如果你想拥有更多，你就要像店铺那样思考。
比尔，在刚才的谈话中，我们讨论了三种人：生产者、消费者和生产消费者。你能够为我们详细的分析一下他们的区别吗？生产者、消费者和生产消费者，这三者到底有什么区别呢？
凯瑟琳，这三种人的区别在于他们的心态， 他们的思维模式。请记住，如果你想拥有更多，你就要像店铺那样思考，因为店铺赚钱，而消费者花钱。
对。
让我们来看看生产者和消费者的对比。很大程度上，我们从小就被培养成了消费者。大人们教我们购物，教我们寻找折扣商品，教我们像消费者一样思考。
确实没错。
我们去工作，用我们的时间来换金钱，然后我们用那些钱来买一些会随着时间的流逝而贬值的消耗品。这是消费者的心态。消费者考虑的是短期的状况，他们只在等待下一张工资单，这样他们就可以花掉那笔钱。让我们来谈谈消费者债务。你知道，在过去五六年里，美国的消费者债务，也就是信用卡债务，增加了一倍。现在平均每个家庭的消费者债务是$8000，我们把它叫做消费者债务。我们怎样知道这是消费者债务呢？因为这个数字来自购物行为。
对。
另一方面，生产者考虑的比较长远，他们在想怎样才能创造财富。他们考虑的不是怎样省钱，而是怎样创造长远的收入，并且建立资产。这两种人的思维有着天渊之别。消费者考虑的是短期的状况，他们只是在考虑购物和花钱，然后他们很快就会负债累累。生产者考虑问题比较长远，他们考虑的是销售，是如何建立拥有者权益，而不是负债。
这就是赚钱和花钱的区别。
完全正确。这个简单的例子清楚地阐述了两者思维的区别。生产消费者意识到他们的特长就是花钱，他们说，嘿，我擅长花钱，我擅长购物和花钱，我需要花钱，我需要买到某种东西。然而生产消费者还会考虑的是，我要在哪里花钱，怎样花钱，我是花钱去创造负债，还是花钱创造财富。
是的。
生产消费者和消费者之间还有一个明显的区别，生产消费者的思维更像生产者，他们像店铺那样思考，所以他们才能拥有更多。比起当一个生产者，生产消费者还有什么优势呢？生产者拥有一个生意，一个庞大的生意，他要有厂房、雇员和库存，
还有日常开支。
没错，日常开支。每天早上，生产者一起床就要马上上班，因为他得支付日常开支。
是的。
在他们创造收入之前，他们必须支付日常开支。生产消费者利用科技的便利，还有我们经营生意的模式的变化，改变他们的思维模式。他们把自己从消费者思维中释放出来，也就是短期的思维。他们像生产者那样思考，也就是长远的思维，并且创造财富。
对。
他们是通过合伙的方式来经营他们的生意，这样他们的风险就更低了。他们不必支付日常开支，他们不需要投入资金，他们不需要雇员，但是他们能够享受改变思维模式的好处，创造收入而不是支出。
比尔，听起来生产消费者是一个能同时拥有蛋糕，并且能够享受蛋糕的美味的人。
没错，只要他们从正确的商店里购买。
对，因为他们在花钱的时候还能够赚钱呢。
因为他们创造了财富而不是债务，这是完全不同的思维模式。但是凯瑟琳，这里有一个很好的消息，你要做的只是改变你的思维模式，当然要有一些行动，但是你要做的只是改变你的思维模式。这很简单，但同时也有困难，你要做的就是学会改变你的思维模式。
好的，所以生产消费者的思维模式就是他们像消费者那样购物，但是像生产者那样思考和行动，对吗？
你的说法比我的好多了。
比尔，你有一个对于价格的非常独特的定义。我一直认为价格就是你购买一样东西所支付的钱，但你所说的价格很不一样，你可以解释一下你对此的想法吗？
好的，消费者认为价格就是价格标签上的金额，他们从货架上找到商品，把价格标签翻过来看看， 他们认为那就是他们所支付的价格。但是价格其实是你为了得到你想要的东西而放弃的一切。
价格是你为了得到你想要的东西而放弃的一切。
没错，我们就以大型货仓式折扣店为例吧。当你去那里买45加仑装的泡菜，你就放弃了便利。当你付款的时候，没有人帮你把商品放进袋子里，你必须自己带购物袋或者箱子，真的很麻烦。凯瑟琳，请记住，店铺不会像消费者那样思考，他们像生产者那样思考，他们可能会给你折扣，但他们这样做只是为了吸引你，然后说服你买其他的东西。你下次去大型货仓式折扣店的时候，请留意付款柜台。付款柜台上都摆满了一些糖果、巧克力等等，那些都不是你的购物清单上的东西，对吗？当你去一家商店买折扣商品时，他们却成功地向你销售了别的东西。他们的是店铺的心态，这是很不错的思维，他创造了生意，还创造了财富。但是消费者落入了这个圈套中，因为他们用消费者模式来思维，他们认为价格就是标签上的金额。实际上，当你付钱买了某种商品的时候，你就放弃了某些东西。生产消费者不会放弃消费者所放弃的东西。生产消费者抓住机会，而消费者放弃机会。当你作为生产消费者去买东西，你在你自己的店里支付相同的价格，但是你买的不仅是那件商品，你还买了创造财富的机会。
因为你在花钱的同时还能够赚钱。
在花钱的同时还能够赚钱。那些钱以机会的形式呈现在你面前，你可以采取行动去创造财富。如果你在大型货仓式折扣店买了日用品，一旦这些日用品被消耗了，你就一无所有了。
你的钱就一去不返了，就像刚才租用和拥有的例子。
如果你从自己的店里购物，你就购买了机会。你教别人做同样的事情，你就能创造财富。当你有了不同的思维，你就会得到不同的结果。如果你想拥有更多，你就要像店铺那样思维。
好的，比尔，我们已经建立了一个概念，生产消费就是通过更聪明而不是更便宜的购物来创造财富。如果你想拥有更多，你就要像店铺那样思考，生产消费者的思维就像生产者的思维，而不是消费者的思维。现在你能告诉我们，怎样把拥有自己的房子这个概念延伸到其他方面的生产消费上吗？
凯瑟琳，没问题。作为一个生产消费者，创造财富有四个步骤。第一，你要找一个系统，一个现成的系统，你不必自己创造一个。当斯坦先生的店铺建立那个系统的时候，那个系统是现成的，人们只需要加入这个系统。
对呀，他已经有一家店铺了。
你不需要自己重新发明车轮，现在的车轮已经很不错了。你只需要加入生产消费者的系统，并且紧紧地跟随他。第二，你要与生产者合伙建立一家商店，以便你自己和别人可以在这里购物。在科技发达的今天，我们可以通过网站或者目录等购物。建立一家商店并不意味着你要用砖头和水泥去盖一家商店，以便你作为生产消费者可以避免那些日常开支。第三，要在你自己的店里购物。如果你有一家餐厅，你不会到别人的餐厅里举行生日晚会，对吧？要开晚会的话，当然要在你自己的餐厅。
当然不会去别人的餐厅了。
你会把生意留给你自己做，所以要对你的产品供应伙伴忠诚，要对你的系统忠诚，要对你自己忠诚，这样才能创造财富。
就是说，如果你拥有一家凯马特，你就不会到沃尔玛购物。
当然，最后也就是第四点，你要介绍其他人来这家商店购物。我们要把人们引导到这里，让我们的商店热闹起来。我们希望人们来这里购物，他们会像我们一样得到好处的。 他们放弃某些东西来换取他们想要的东西时，他们得到的是机会。
他们也能在花钱的同时赚钱吗？
可以，人们可以通过三个途径来加入这个过程。
是哪三个途径呢？
第一，他们可以单纯为了折扣而购物。只要你对商店忠诚，对系统忠诚，你就会从你购买的商品中得到折扣，这是其中一个简单的方法。第二，他们可以扩大他们的销售生意，以便可以每个月赚几百美元的兼职收入。很多人都这样做，这是一个非常可行的方法。第三，你看到这个生意的巨大前景，完全投入到这个生意里，在这个生意中建立拥有者权益，然后教别人做同样的事情。这样你就可以取得财务自由，不再需要用时间来换金钱。你可以创造让你获得自由的永续收入，为自己和家人创造独特的生活方式和未来，这是任何其他方法都做不到的。
比尔，这很有趣。
参与的程度完全由每个人自己来决定。请记住一点，如果你这辈子还没有做过什么让你走向富裕的事情，请记住，通往富裕的道路允许掉头。你可以在今天做出改变，在明天取得成果。
比尔，听起来生产消费有很多优点，几乎没什么缺点。如果真的是这样，为什么不是全世界每个人都参与呢？
凯瑟琳，现在已经有数以百万计的人们加入了生产消费者的行列，他们遍布全球。遗憾的是，还有很多很多人仍然固守旧的模式。他们认为，只要有一份工作，努力地做，当他们在65岁退休的时候，他们就可以得到财务保障和财富。这种模式已经行不通了。所以，我们要让人们接触这个概念，教他们如何以不同的模式来思考。如果你以不同的模式来思考，你就可以拥有更多。
好的，比尔，我们今天的访问快结束了，你能为听众们总结一下什么是生产消费吗？
当然可以。生产消费者把自己定位成更聪明而不是更便宜的购物而创造财富的人。女士们，先生们，请问问你自己，你想更慢一点变贫穷呢，还是更快一点变富裕呢？这是一个很重要的问题。当你购买折扣商品的时候，当你从这家商店穿过整个城市去到另一家商店寻找更多的折扣的时候，毫无疑问，你只是在减慢你花钱的速度，但是你仍然在花钱，你仍然要开支。当你创造财富的时候，当你创造收入的时候，你是在快速地变得富裕。你可以选择更慢一点变得贫穷，或者更快一点变得富裕，选择权在你手中。但是你下次去大型折扣店购买健康和美容产品的时候，你能够发现他们在谈论机会吗？你下次买家居清洁用品的时候，商店的过道上面是否写着机会就在这里，请在这里购物吧？不，你只是在花钱，所以你要做的只是改变你的思维模式。各位朋友，这盒录音带只是很表面地介绍了生产消费这个概念，我们只是谈了一些皮毛的东西。如果你想了解更多关于如何在花钱的同时赚钱的信息，去找提供这盒录音带的人吧，他们可以详细地给你讲解生产消费的概念。选择权就在你手上，你想获得折扣、兼职收入、实现财务自由呢，还是花15到20年的时间继续做你现在的工作呢？
谢谢你，比尔，你给了我们的听众一个令人兴奋的概念，很值得回味。生产消费者力量在面试的短短的一年时间里，销量超过50万本，而且被翻译成12种语言。我认为生产消费不仅是一种运动，它已经成为了一场革命，你同意吗？
是的，凯瑟琳，它已经成为了一场全球性的革命。我给所有听众一个建议，参加这个生产消费者的革命，赢得你的经济自由。
Ask yourself this question. Do you own your life or are you just renting?
Catherine Glover, the president of INTI Publishing. I'm here today to interview Dr. Bill Quain about his best-selling book, Prosumer Power. Author of 9 books, a speaker, and a consultant, Bill was a business owner by the time he was 19. A real renaissance man, Bill Quain is a professor of marketing at a university in Florida and has been recognized as outstanding professor by 4 colleges. Legally blind since the age of 14, Bill Quain has never let his handicap stop him. In fact, he's never even let it slow him down. Because he can't drive a car, he goes to and from the university by kayak. The irony is, people are always looking to Bill for a vision of their future.
Catherine, great to talk with you today and with our listeners. You know, you're right. I appreciate that nice introduction there. Because I'm legally blind, I look at things a different way. And going to work by kayak has been one of those things. It's been a great experience, and it gives me time to think every morning. It's just fantastic. So I'm happy to be here and happy to share this great concept of prosumerism with our listeners.
It does sound like a great way to get to work, Bill, missing the traffic and the exhaust fumes.
It's terrific. I've never had road rage out there on the water.
Well, Bill, as you know, I love this book, Prosumer Power, and I love this whole concept. Before I read the manuscript of this book, I had never heard the word prosumer. Of course, I've heard the word consumer, but never prosumer. Can you tell our listeners how that word came about, Bill?
Absolutely. Prosumer is a combination of the word consumer and producer. We all know what consumers are. They're people who spend money.
Right.
And all of us are consumers. We buy the things we need for everyday use. We know what producers are. Producers make money. Consumers spend money, and producers make money. Well, what prosumers do, Catherine, is they make money while they spend. In fact, prosumers have learned to position themselves to create wealth by buying smarter, not cheaper.
Great. So prosumers make money while they spend money.
Absolutely. And it's a fantastic concept, and that's exactly what we're going to explain on this tape.
It really is a very intriguing concept, Bill. Could you give us an example of prosuming in action?
Absolutely, Catherine. And it's an example that everyone will understand because everyone's involved in it. Let's look at the title of this tape. Do you own your life or are you just renting? We can use that title to explain prosumerism because everyone understands the fact that it's better to own your own home than to rent it. Home ownership is the cornerstone of the American dream. And we're trained from an early age to find some way to buy our own home and to create equity in that home. And each month when we make our mortgage payment on a house, we are actually spending some money in interest, it's true, but we're also spending money towards principal, and that builds equity in that house. As opposed to someone who rents a house, every month when they spend that money, it simply goes away. Now, take an example of, and we'll use round numbers here, Catherine, even though they may not be quite realistic, but they're easy to get a grasp of.
Right, okay.
Let's suppose that you could buy a house for $1,000 a month, or you can rent that same house for $500 a month. In the case of buying the home, you're laying out $12,000 a year, $1,000
right.
a month.
Mm-hmm.
But that money is going towards building equity in your home. It's creating ownership. If you were to spend $500 a month, you would only spend $6,000 a year, but every bit of that $6,000 will go into the pocket of your landlord to build his or her dream of homeownership, not yours. Now, you see, the thing is about being a prosumer, remember we said that prosumers position themselves to create wealth by buying smarter, not cheaper. Well, if we buy a home where we have a mortgage and we pay off that mortgage and build equity and take advantage of appreciation and that sort of thing, we're buying smarter, not necessarily cheaper. We could choose to rent, and maybe that would cost us less money. That would be cheaper, but not smarter. Let's look at a couple of the contrasting items here between owning a home and renting a home. And this applies directly to, do you want to own your life, or are you just renting? If you own a home, you're getting an investment. If you rent, you have an expense. Money simply goes out of your pocket and never comes back. If you own a home, you take advantage of appreciation. If the value of the home goes up, that's money in your pocket when you go to sell the home. If you're renting a home, that appreciation goes to your landlord.
Exactly.
And he or she is making the money that you could have made. When we own, we create wealth. When we rent, we spend our wealth. When we own, we get tax advantages, and the government actually pays part of our mortgage for us. When we rent, the landlord gets the tax advantages. And finally, when we own a home, we build equity. And equity is what leads us to long-term wealth creation. So owning a home is a great example of prosumer power.
It really is, isn't it?
Yes, and you know, the great thing is everyone understands that. If you look at the United States, did you know that fully two-thirds of the people in the United States own their own home? And I'll bet you the other third would like to. There's something that's holding them back. Maybe they don't have the down payment. Perhaps they're in a situation where they're in transition. Whatever it happens to be, one of the things that has built a rock-solid foundation of our country's economy is home ownership. And our tax laws are geared to help protect that. And all that is prosumer power at work. And we're going to take those same principles of home ownership and apply them to everyday purchases and show people how they can create investment, equity, tax advantages, and wealth by using prosumer power to buy smarter, not cheaper, and position themselves to create wealth.
Bill, you have a story that you love to tell about the hazards of renting versus owning. Could you share that with our listeners?
Sure, and this comes directly from Garrison Keillor, Catherine. He tells a story that I just love about a fellow whose uncle died. And this man, he loved his uncle. His uncle had been really great to him during his life, and he wanted to give his uncle the best funeral he could. Unfortunately, this gentleman was too busy at work to go to the funeral. But he called the funeral director up and he said, "Give my uncle a terrific funeral. It's really important to me, and just send me the bill." So the funeral occurred. The guy couldn't make it because he was real busy. But about a month later, he gets a bill from the funeral parlor for $32,000. And he thinks to himself, "Well, that's a lot of money. But, you know, I told him to go first class, and that was just perfect for my uncle. He deserved that." Well, a month after that, he gets a bill for $85. From the funeral parlor.
Mm-hmm.
And he thinks to himself, "Well, this is strange," but he pays it and sends it off. Well, this continues for several months. Every month he's getting a bill for $85 and he keeps paying it, sending it in. But finally, after 4 or 5 months, he's got to get the explanation here of what's going on. So he calls up the director of the funeral parlor and he said, "Look, you did a great job for my uncle. Everyone says so. I couldn't be there myself, but I'm curious about why do I get a bill every month for $85? And the funeral director says, "Well, it's simple. You told us to do everything first class for your uncle." He said, "I certainly did." He said, "Well, we wanted him to look good, so we rented a tuxedo for him." So now here's a guy that for the rest of his life is going to be paying for that tuxedo. Because
renting a tuxedo.
He rented, and he should have bought.
That's right, Bill. You know, I've often heard you say, if you want to have more, think like a store. You tell a story in the book about Stan's store, which I think is a great example of being able to think like a store. An even better example of consumers having an opportunity to buy smarter, not cheaper. Could you share that story with us, Bill?
Absolutely, Catherine, and you're right. Stan's store is a great example. You see, people have to learn to think different. If you learn to think different, you can create wealth. If you think the same, you'll always have what you've had before. Now, Stan was a fellow who thought different, and this is a great example of how we work in partnership with people here. Let me explain. See, Stan owned a store in a small town in the Midwest, and he had that store for years. It was on Main Street, and he had loyal customers who would just go to his store because they liked Stan. And he gave them great service, and he had good prices. But one day, Stan went to work, and he saw some construction on the street. On the one side of his store was a great big building going up called the Giant Discount Warehouse Store. On the other side of his store was a super going-out-of-business-get-your-prices-now store. You know, and these are stores that were competing on price. And pretty soon, Stan's loyal customers started fleeing from his store, trying to get discounts in these big stores.
Right.
And so Stan decided he had to do something about it. So he thought to himself, "What am I going to do? What am I going to do?" And he called in his sales staff, and no one seemed to have a good idea. And then one day, one of his former loyal customers walked into his store, looked around, and said, "Oh, I'm sorry, I'm in the wrong store. This is Stan's store. And a little light bulb went over Stan's head, and he said, you know, that's the problem. He said, my customers think of this as being my store, and what I want to do is have them think of it as being their store.
Right.
Yeah, so he thought of a way to give people money back and help them create income by doing two things, either shopping at his store, and he would give them rebates, or referring other people to his store, and then he would give people commissions. Now, Stan went even a little bit further than that. He, as his former loyal customers started coming back and seeing his good service and his honesty and his selection and all the good things, and paying a fair and reasonable price, Stan said to them, I'll tell you what, you refer this store, which used to be Stan's store, now we're going to call it your store. You refer it to other people, get them to come in, and I'll give you a commission on that. And furthermore, if those people bring other people in, I'll still give you a commission on the sales that they generate. So all of a sudden, what was happening was consumers were turning into prosumers. And Stan, who was a producer, was partnering with the prosumers. And that's what we do in Prosumer Power.
So Stan was basically, he began treating his customers like affiliate partners, basically, almost like fellow producers instead of as just consumers.
Exactly right, Catherine. That took some education on both Stan's part and the part of the consumers. Because in the consumer mentality, they were just running next door to the discount. If he could show them through success and wealth building how to become prosumers, then they soon started shopping at their own store.
Right.
They were partners with Stan.
Right.
And showing other people how to do the same thing. That's the essence of prosumer power, to buy from yourself and your affiliate partners and build wealth by teaching other people how to change their buying habits as well. You buy from my mart instead of the other mart.
So he allowed them, Stan allowed these people to own their own independent business, to buy from themselves, from their own store, to buy smarter, not cheaper, and best of all, to make money while they spent money.
See, they were still buying consumables, the things that they were always buying. And no one bought more than they had been buying before. They still just bought simply the things they were buying before. They just bought them in a different manner. They changed their buying habits. They changed their thinking. And then they changed their lives.
Right. Stan taught them, if you want to have more, you have to think like a store.
And that's a great clue for our listeners. You see, consumers spend money. And that money is outgo. Stores make money. That money is income. Would you rather think like someone who's creating outgo or someone who's creating income? So consumers, to become prosumers, have to start thinking like a store. If you want more, you must think like a store.
Bill, we've talked about three different groups so far in our discussion. Producers, consumers, and prosumers. Can you describe each of these groups a little bit, clarify for us what is the difference between a consumer and a producer and a producer and a prosumer?
Catherine, the difference between these three groups is their mentality, the way they think. Remember, if you want more, you must think like a store because stores make money and consumers spend money.
Right.
So let's contrast quickly producers and consumers. We're raised, by and large, to be consumers. We're taught to shop, and we're taught to look for discounts, and we're taught to think like people who are spending money.
Right.
We go to work.
Sadly.
We trade our time for dollars, and then we trade those dollars for consumable things that depreciate and have less value later on. That's the consumer mentality. The consumer thinks short term. They're only looking for the next paycheck to come in so they can spend that paycheck. Listen, we could talk about consumer debt, and did you know that consumer debt has doubled? Credit card debt has doubled in about the last 5 or 6 years in this country. So now the average family has about $8,000 in consumer debt. And we call it consumer debt. And how do we know it's consumer debt? Because we got it by buying stuff.
That's right.
Now, producers, on the other hand, think long term. They're thinking about how to create wealth. They're not thinking about how to save money. They're thinking about how to create long-term income and building equity. A vast difference
Yes.
in the way those two groups think. Consumers think short-term. They think buying and spending and going into debt. And producers think long-term. They think selling, and they think building equity rather than going to debt.
So it's make money versus spend money.
Absolutely. A simple case of a clear difference in the way that they think. Now, the prosumers are a group who realize what it is they do best is spend money. They say, hey, I'm good at spending money. I'm good at shopping and spending money. And I need to spend money. I need to get certain things. But what prosumers think about is where and how do I spend my money? Do I spend my money to create debt? Or do I spend my money to create wealth?
Okay.
Again, another clear distinction between prosumers and consumers. Prosumers think more like producers. They think like the store, therefore they can have more. What's the advantage, Catherine, between being a prosumer versus being a producer? A producer has a business, a big business, and it has walls and employees and inventory.
And overhead.
Overhead.
Right.
Every morning when the producer wakes up, they've got to go to work quickly just to pay for the overhead.
That's right.
Before they start generating income. Prosumers take advantage of technology and the changes in the way we do business and the changes in thinking, and they free themselves from consumer thinking, that is short-term, debt-creating consumer thinking, and they think like producers, that is long-term wealth creating,
okay.
But they do it by partnering so that their risk is lower. They don't have the overhead, they don't have the investment, they don't have the employees, but they enjoy the benefits of changing their thinking to create income rather than outgo.
So in a way, Bill, it sounds like prosumers can sort of have their cake and eat it too.
Absolutely, as long as they buy it from the right store.
Right, because they can make money while they spend money.
Because they're creating wealth rather than creating debt. And
right.
That's a whole different way of thinking. But Catherine, here's the great news. All it is a change in thinking. Of course, you have to follow that with some actions, but all it requires is that you change your thinking. And that's a simple thing to do. It's difficult to do, but it's simple to do. What you simply have to do is to learn to think different.
Okay. So prosumer thinking is buying like a consumer, but thinking and acting like a producer. Is that right?
I couldn't have said it better myself. Move to the head of the class.
Bill, you have a very unique definition of price. I always thought price was just the money you paid for a product. But you say that price is something very different. Can you explain your thinking on that?
Sure. Consumers think that price is the price tag. They look at something on a shelf or on a rack and they turn the price tag over and they think that's what they're paying. But price is everything you give up to get what you want.
Price is everything you give up to get what you want. Okay.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. And so when you go to a store and you're shopping for discounts, that store is set up to give you a discount, but you've given something else up. Take your giant discount warehouse store, for example. When you go there and you buy the pickles, which is a 45-gallon jar of pickles, you know, you've given up convenience. When you try to check out and there's no one there to bag the stuff for you, you have to bring your own bag, your own boxes. It's more inconvenience. You may
right.
have traveled somewhere to get that. And, Catherine, remember this. These stores are not thinking like consumers. They're thinking like producers. They may be offering a discount, but they're doing it for a reason. That's to get you in there, and then they're going to try to sell you other things. So next time you go to the giant discount warehouse store, watch the checkout counter. Here it comes. Milk, bread, eggs, cheese, butter, 5-foot silk plant.
Five-foot silk plant?
Sure. That was on your shopping list, wasn't it? But see, you went in there to get a discount on that, and then they sold you something else. The way that they think, it's the store mentality. Hey, it's a great mentality. It builds business, and it builds wealth. But the consumers fall prey to that because they're thinking like consumers and they think price is simply the price tag. When you pay a price for something, you give up something. And you know what consumers are giving up that prosumers don't give up? Prosumers get opportunity and consumers give up opportunity when they buy. You see, when you buy as a prosumer, you're paying a fair and equitable price from your own store, but what you're buying is not only that item, you're buying the opportunity to create wealth.
Because you're able to make money while you spend money.
You're making money while you spend money.
Okay.
And that money comes in the form of opportunity, which you must then act on to create wealth. You see, if you buy a consumable and consume it at a giant discount warehouse store, you have nothing left.
The money's gone forever, just like in your example, renting versus owning.
If you buy something from yourself at your own store and you buy opportunity and then act on it, you can build wealth by teaching other people to do the same thing. When you think different, you can have different results. If you want to have more, you must think like a store.
Okay, Bill. So we've established that prosuming is creating wealth by buying smarter, not cheaper. If you want to have more, think like a store. Prosumer thinking is thinking like a producer instead of thinking like a consumer. Now can you tell us how to expand this concept of owning your own home, that is, prosuming, to all of your purchasing decisions?
Catherine, no problem. There are four steps people must take in order to create wealth by being prosumers. Number one, you have to find a system, something that's already in place so you don't have to invent it yourself. When Stan and his store set up a system, you know, that was a system that was in place and people just had to plug into it.
Right, he already had a store.
Yeah, you don't want to be out there reinventing the wheel. Wheels are doing pretty well, I think. And so what we want to do is just plug into prosumer systems and get into one and stick with it. Number two, you want to partner with producers to create a store where you and other people can shop. Now, the great thing about today with technology and so on, this can be virtual. It can be as simple as a website, whatever, a catalog. Creating this store doesn't mean putting up walls. Remember, you're a prosumer. You're avoiding overhead.
Right.
Number three, buy from your own store. If you had a restaurant, you wouldn't go out to celebrate and go to somebody else's restaurant to celebrate. You'd go to your own.
Probably not.
You know, you'd give yourself the business. And so become loyal to your corporate partners, become loyal to your system, and become loyal to yourself to create wealth.
Just like you said, if you owned a Kmart, you certainly wouldn't shop at Walmart.
Absolutely. You know, you just don't find those people in there. And finally, number four, we want to refer others to this store. We want to drive traffic to the store. We want people to shop there, and by the way, they're going to get benefits just like we got benefits. And so the reason they're going to be able to create loyalty is because they're going to get opportunity when they give up something to get what they want.
They also can make money while they spend money.
Yes, and there's three ways that people can participate in the store system process.
Okay,
The first way is they can simply shop for rebates. That is, if you're loyal to a store and loyal to a store within this system, you're going to get rebates for the things you buy. That's one simple way of doing it. Number two, they can begin to grow the business a little bit, and they can do that simply to make a few extra $100 a month to create some part-time income. A lot of people do that, and that's certainly a very viable thing to do. And number three, you can throw yourself into this thing. You can really get the big picture here, and you can strive and achieve financial freedom. In other words, you can create residual income that frees you up from having to trade your time for dollars by building equity in a business, teaching other people to do the same thing, and create a lifestyle and a future for yourself and your family that can be achieved in no other way.
Very interesting, Bill. Exciting, too.
The level of participation is simply up to the individual. And here's one thing to remember. If you haven't been doing something in your life that's been moving you towards wealth, the road to wealth allows for U-turns. You can change today and get the results tomorrow.
Bill, it sounds like there's an awful lot of upside to prosuming and very little downside. If that's the case, why isn't everyone involved?
Well, Catherine, there are already thousands and thousands of people thinking like prosumers, and they're all over the world. But unfortunately, many, many people are still caught in the old paradigm of thinking that you get a job, you work hard, and you keep your nose to the grindstone,
right,
and you retire at 65, and that will create some sort of financial security and wealth. It just isn't working. And so what it takes is it takes people being exposed to the idea and shown how to think different. If you think different, you can have more.
Okay, Bill, we're nearing the end of our interview here. So can you sum up what prosuming is all about for our listeners?
Sure. Prosumers position themselves to create wealth by buying smarter, not cheaper. Ladies and gentlemen, ask yourself this question. Would you rather get poor slower or get rich faster? That's the big question. You see, when you shop at discounts, when you fly from one store to the other across town looking for discounts, sure, you slow down the rate at which you're spending money, but you're still spending money. You're still having outgo. When you create wealth, when you create income, you're getting rich faster. You can get poor slower, or you can get rich faster. The choice is yours. The next time you go shopping at your giant discount store and you're looking in the health and beauty aid section, can you find the part where they talk about opportunity? The next time you're buying your home cleaning supplies, is there an aisle there that says, here's the opportunity, buy here? No, you're spending money. All it takes is thinking different. You know, in this short tape, we've covered this prosuming aspect, but only on the surface. We've just scratched it. If you'd like to learn more about how to make money while you spend money, get back with the person who gave you this tape. They can color in the details of the big picture. And then the choice is yours. Would you like to get rebates, part-time income, or full-scale financial freedom? Or do you want to spend another 15 to 20 years doing what you've done so far?
Thank you, Bill. You've given our listeners some exciting concepts to think about. And given the fact that your book, Prosumer Power, is approaching 500,000 copies in sales and has been translated into 12 languages after being in the marketplace for a little more than a year, I'd say prosuming is more than a movement. I'd say it's becoming a revolution. Wouldn't you agree?
Yes, Catherine, it's a worldwide revolution. And my advice to anyone listening to this tape is to enlist in the prosumer revolution and win the fight for financial freedom.